actually it's great to be here in Italy, which is the birthplace of geometric measure theory in which I work. In fact, one of my favorite old pictures is this one that was taken back in Pisa in 1965, which shows maybe the father of geometric measure theory, De Giorgi, there on the steps of the Scuola Normale Superiore in Pisa, on the right, and in the middle is my own PhD advisor, Fred Ombren, and on the left you see Wendell Fleming. Now, Ombren and De Giorgi unfortunately died about 20 years ago, about the same time, but Wendell Fleming is still going strong. This picture was taken by Mario Miranda, who carried geometric measure theory to the north of Italy, starting in Trento in particular. And in fact, that when I first visited, there I am in my first visit in 1977, and there is Mario Miranda. And I wanted to take a minute because he just passed on earlier this year. And I wanted to take this minute to remember him, who did so much to make it possible what we're doing here today. From the beginning, one of the fundamental problems in geometric measure theory was this isoperimetric problem, which I'm going to describe today, in particular in the presence of a density. So let me start with density. So density, this is just like in physics. It's some positive quantity, some positive function that scales up everything, volume and perimeter equally. So weighted volume is just this density, I'm calling it psi times unweighted volume. Weighted perimeter is just psi times unweighted perimeter. This is actually something that's very, it's simpler and more fundamental than, say, a conformal change of metric when you scale things up. You know, when you scale things up, you multiply length by one factor, lambda, then you multiply area by lambda squared, and then you multiply volume by lambda cubed. That's more complicated here. Everything gets multiplied by that same factor. Everything just gets multiplied by that same factor. It's something that we see in calculus, actually. So here's a page from a calculus book. When you study areas and volumes of revolution, you know that formula, that an area of revolution you get by just integrating the circumference of revolution, 2 pi x, over the generating curve. And similarly, you compute a volume of revolution by integrating that same density over the generating region in the plane. So when you're studying 3D, you've really reduced it to looking at the generating objects in the plane. If you take R3 and mod out by rotations, what you really get is the plane or half plane with this density 2 pi x. And that's a much more general phenomenon. When you can start out with any manifold, mod out by isometries, and you get a space that has density. But this is just one little example from calculus. Here's an example from politics. Election districts should minimize weighted perimeter for given weighted area. Now, you know, historically, politicians design these really crazy districts to the advantage of themselves or their parties. It would be fairer to let math do it. What would the density be? The density would be the population density. Then the weighted area would just be the population of the district, which is what we want to fix. We want every district to have the same population. And then we want to minimize the perimeter. You sort of want to minimize the length of the boundary of these regions, but you also want it to avoid the places where the density is very high. So this would be one way of approaching it. But there are many deeper applications in mathematics. I went to this big math conference in Montreal a few years ago, and I asked the young, and I saw, before I went, how many papers were coming out on this subject. I tried to keep a list on my blog here. I can hardly keep up with it. There's a new paper every week. So I asked the young experts at this conference, including Robert McCann and Emmanuel Millman, why density is so important. And this is what Robert had to say to me.
I guess now that
so we have a little problem with this cord here, but we just stick it together better and it'll work better. Yeah, we're an expert at that. No. What?
Rise as limits of metric volume on the sum of dimensions collapse.
So even if you wanted to start out with classical manifolds, in the limit you would get manifolds with density. There's one example. Emmanuel Millman.
I was thinking about why manifolds with density are so interesting because they appear as natural closure diffusion manifolds under natural projection.
Also under projection diffusions. And he mentions Gaussian density, which is by far the most important. So the Gauss plane you could get by just taking R2 with Gaussian density that maybe you're familiar with. It goes down exponentially like e to the minus r squared over 2, where r is the distance from the origin. So it has some value, largest value at the origin, and then it drops off very rapidly. The density is bigger at the origin. As you move away, the space becomes very rarefied. There are lots of applications that you'll see all the time. That weird factor in front there is just to make the total weighted area of the space 1, which is a very nice feature, which is hopeless for Euclidean space. There's no way to normalize Euclidean space. Gauss space is a very nice space. And in any space, my favorite problem is the isoperimetric problem, which is given, which is to enclose given area with minimum perimeter. And you know the answer in the Euclidean plane, right? It's, yes, I heard that. Yes, you said it, what? A circle, yes, a circle. A round circle is the answer. And from a modern point of view, that's a very easy thing to prove. For general reasons, the solution has to have constant curvature, and therefore it has to be a circle. Now let's think about the same problem in the Gauss plane. So what are we doing now? We want to enclose given weighted area with minimum weighted perimeter. But you still have a guess, perhaps. Yes? The circle about the origin, right? Because we still have the rotational symmetry, right? So it looks like it ought to be a circle. And it's easy to check that that circle has constant generalized curvature, where the right generalization of curvature involves not only the classical curvature, but also the derivative of the log of the density. But that's not a proof this time, because it turns out there are other curves with constant generalized curvature. Here are some that were discovered by some of my students back in 2005, looking like a rounded triangle, rounded square, rounded pentagon, rounded hexagon. This was the group of students back then. Actually, it's been fun for me to think about what has happened to these students since 2005. So a couple of them got PhDs and became mathematicians. One of them went on in law, which is great. Math is needed in law. One of them, God bless her, became a high school teacher. I had another student that went on to work with big hedge funds in Boston. And I had one thesis student who went on to become Obama's speechwriter. And then went to Hollywood and started his own primetime television program network. It was called 1600 Penn. So this all just goes to illustrate what you can tell all of your students and friends, that with math, you can do anything. Yeah, remember that. Okay, so back to our problem here. You'll be interested to know that these weird shapes are not minimizing. So we still maybe like the circle they came from. What's your name?
Leonardo.
From Leonardo.
Leonardo.
First person on our list today from Leonardo. You know, because suppose you moved it farther away. Well, since the density is less here, it would have to be bigger, right? But then the density would also be less on the perimeter. And let's see, the fact is that when you scale something up, the area goes up faster than the perimeter does, and this is actually better. So this is very strange. Leonardo, it turns out, was wrong. A good guess, but was wrong. It can't be a circle about the origin. Circles which break the symmetry and move away from the origin actually do better. This is a principle in this business, that isoperimetric regions prefer low density. Now, you know, if you would like to move up front, there like are great seats up here where you won't have to crane your neck. And no, I'm thinking of you, because you're so interested in what we're doing, but it's really hard to see behind these big people. So if you want to come up, you're welcome to. So this is better farther away, but then what could be best? Right? You can't go all the way off to infinity because there's no area out there. The density has gone down to zero. But there is an optimal solution, and it's a shape you've heard of. Now, Leonardo's done his part. Who will make the next guess as what the solution might be? Oh, you have an idea. What shape?
Tangent to the axis.
Something tangent. Oh, a circle tangent to the axis. A circle down here tangent to the axis. Yeah, I kind of like that. Of course, it doesn't really care whether it's tangent to the axis or not, because we have rotational symmetry, right? So we could move this one down tangent to the axis. We could do that. But it would be better if we moved it out farther, and better if we moved it out farther. We don't get a solution yet that's optimal. I like that idea though. What was your name? Your name?
Paolo.
Paolo. Any other ideas? I'm sure it's a shape you've heard of that's new. Does anybody know, by the way, some people may secretly know this. You know the answer. It's probably a shape they've heard of, yes?
I'm sure.
What could it be? You want me to tell you? You give up? It's the shape that's nicer, that's the only shape nicer than the circle. But it's very hard to think of. The answer is a straight line. Now, you never think of that at first, but a straight line is infinitely long, right? But because of the way that the density decays so rapidly, it has finite weighted length. And it does have some finite fraction of the total area one of the plane to the right of it. And it actually is the least perimeter way to enclose that much area. But it's not unique. Wouldn't have to be vertical. It could be horizontal. It could be at any angle. If you want to enclose less area, you just move it to the right. If you want to enclose more area, you just move it to the left. But the answer is always a straight line. Yeah. But you might think, well, this is kind of peculiar. This is because you had this weird example where the density goes to zero at infinity. So I gave my students in 2006 an opposite example where the density goes to infinity at infinity. And the simplest example I could think of, just the power of r. So maybe r squared or r cubed, or maybe just r itself. I want them to work on that problem. And now, of Of course, there's an obvious conjecture. I mean, remember the principle, isoperimetric regions like low density. So now it's happy to be around the origin. And so you're going to guess. Yes, you were ready. Yes, the person looking around towards the back of the room there. Yes, you. No? I didn't have a guess? Yes, I got you again. What's his name? Everyone's pointing at you now. Yes, you, yes, yes.
It really looks like someone who had the answer. But if it goes to infinity, if it becomes higher than infinity, then...
Right, it can't go to infinity now. That's right. Because it would have infinite length.
Maybe this time the circle about the...
Maybe this time the circle about the origin. Thank you, yes. So that's the obvious conjecture. And now we're a little more confident. We understand that these isoperimetric regions like low density. And your name was?
Federico.
Federico.
Yes.
Okay. Good guess. Not right. In fact, it's not even stable. So this was kind of weird when I heard about this. The principle, though, is right. Isoperimetric regions do like low density. And the students were able to prove that the isoperimetric region contains the origin. But it's not a circle about the origin. And so they thought, you know, it's just some transcendental off-center oval that no one would ever know exactly. But that turned out to be wrong. Because 2 years later, the students discovered exactly what the answer was. Found an exact formula for it. Not a circle about the origin, but again, a shape you've heard of. So yesterday in Trento, someone guessed, I actually gave them this question, someone guessed an ellipse with focus at the origin. No, that's not right. We need a guess. Square. You like that better? No, the corners are horrible, very expensive. The Witch of Amici? I don't even know what that is. I sold that in my calculus book once. Any ideas, anybody? Maybe instead of a circle, something like x to the fourth plus y to the fourth equals one? No. All right, I will tell you. It's not a circle about the origin. It's a circle through the origin. Now, first when I saw this, I thought this was very strange, right? Because how could this have constant generalized curvature? This is a constant regular curvature. And then there's another term involving the derivative of the log of the density, and the density is changing as you're moving away from the origin, which is just so very unlikely. But it is the right solution, a circle through the origin. That makes some sense that the perimeter wants to go, since we want the perimeter to be small, that it goes through the place where the density is zero. Maybe that makes sense. In fact, that's a little like what happened back in the Gauss plane, right? It was a line, that is a circle through infinity where the density was zero. Yeah, so maybe that makes some sense. And it turns out, as was discovered 6 years later, that this is true in higher dimensions too. That if you're in Rn with density r to the p, any p, The isoperimetric solution is a sphere that goes through the origin. And it's amazing. It's the same answer, all dimensions, any positive power, any given volume, always a sphere through the origin. Always a sphere through the origin. So the next summer, I took my group to the World Center for Studying Such Problems. That was Granada, Spain, where they looked at the same problem, except not in the whole plane, but just in a sector. Just in a sector. And all you have to do is go from one side to the other side. And now, are you ready to make the guess? Now you are ready, I think. In this sector, what do you think the minimizer is? Minimized perimeter. Come on, don't give up now, you were so close. Yeah, go ahead, say it. This nice person in the center here. What's his name? On your left. Yeah, on your left. See the person on your left? Yeah, you, on your left. That guy. Tall guy there with the glasses. And a nice sweater. Yes, yes! The one who's desperately looking around. No, not him. The guy here in front of him. Yes, right here. Yes, you! Take a guess. The boundary is free, remember. All we have to do is go from here to here.
A piece of circle?
Yes, a circular arc, finally, exactly right. The arc of a circle centered at the origin, right. That's true for when the angle is small. Finally, we get a circle centered at the origin. But when you have bigger angles, it's more like the circle through the origin, a semicircle through the origin. And then what happens in between? Do you think it jumps from this to this? Or do you think there's a smooth transition? How many people think it jumps? Everybody has to vote. How many people think it jumps? How many people think it's a smooth transition? Oh, we have to vote again. You have to vote. How many people think it jumps? How many people think a smooth transition? Jumps, I think, won the vote. Jumps won the vote. The truth of the matter is, smooth transition through this, just very briefly, through this undulatory shape, for this undulatory shape. So, and that happens when p equals 1 at about 3 pi over 2 there. At about, what is that? That's pi, 3 pi over 4. About 3 pi over 4 there. Yeah, about 3 pi over 4. Here you can see it's pretty much a circular arc up until 3 pi over 4. Then it's something a little funny starts to happen, gets a little weird, and then it heads quickly down to a semicircle. It takes about 8 degrees for that change to happen. One of the students, Sean Hamley, did a little movie of it for you. So you see, it starts out being a circular arc as the sector gets longer and longer. 8 degrees before 3 pi over 4, there's this rapid change, transition down to the semicircle. So that's just numerical there. But they're actually able to prove that, theoretically, that for small angles it's a circular arc, then there's a transition, and it goes through these undularities, and then there's a transition point again when it changes to the semicircle. Able to prove all that. The only thing that they couldn't prove is exactly when the switch from the circle to the undulary, and from the undulary to the semicircle. Their theory was that the circle is minimizing as long as it's stable. And all the numerical evidence supported that conjecture. But they were not able to prove that. Here were the four guys in Granada that summer. I asked them if they had anything to say to you, and here's what Alexander had to say. He said, the first minimizer arcs, then come the undulates, then the semicircle forever. And Nate said, we hoped that circles around the origin would be isoperimetric as long as they were stable, and that's exactly what the numerical evidence suggests. And then finally, Alexander summed the whole thing up this way. Descubrimos la combinación perfecta, problemas isoperimétricos, Granada y nosotros. Yeah. So actually, this transition question, you know, they were really eager to know something about, so they reformulated it analytically as an inequality in polar coordinates for r as a function of alpha over some range as q ranges from 1 to 2. And on the left-hand side, this is a very familiar thing called the LQ norm. You take r to the qth power, integrate it, take that to the 1 over q power. The right-hand side is something much more complicated, kind of ugly, involving the derivative of r with respect to alpha. And so this is supposed to hold over this whole range. Notice when q is 1, you just get the integral of r on the left. And on the right, this term goes away, and you get the square root of r squared, the integral of r again. So it's trivial. When q is 2, it's the standard isoperimetric inequality. And so this is a kind of interpolation in between. So once you put it in analytic form like this, now a lot of analysts get interested in it and started working on it, but they got nowhere. So that didn't seem to help. That question remained open. By the way, we have a lot of students every summer. They come to do research in mathematics on open questions. Undergraduates from around the world. Application is in early February. So plenty of time for the summer of 2018. And I hope that we're going to have some from Italy next year. That would be great. We'd like that. Okay, so back to this result. Remember, this was a result, circle through the origin, for positive powers. What happens with, say, very negative powers? Well, it turns out when p is less than minus 2, now the density is blowing up at the origin, we don't like being there, and going to 0 at infinity. Now it turns out that the answer is a circle about the origin, only the area is on the outside. This is actually a much easier example. And then, when you take r to the minus 1 in between, the isoperimetric region is neither the circle through the origin nor the circle about the origin. In fact, it doesn't exist. There is no isoperimetric solution. In fact, you can get a perimeter as small as you like by just taking a very big annulus. And you can have the perimeter go down, 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 as close to 0 as you like, without ever reaching perimeter 0. So this, by the way, is a typical kind of question in geometric measure theory. Existence, right? Does a nice solution exist? In this case, in general, no. The biggest result in this is by the Italian school. A recent paper just published last month, I think, that said that at least when you have radial densities, as we've been looking at, when they're increasing, not like r to the minus 1, but when they're increasing, then you're guaranteed to have existence. So that's a nice result in geometric measure theory. The other big theoretical topics are regularity, how nice is the solution? And it's known that if the density is nice, the solution is nice. And computation, which is how can you compute the solutions? That's difficult too, all difficult. So we've been very frustrated in trying to hope that the solution was a circle about the origin, right? That didn't happen in the Gaussian case when the density was going to 0. And it didn't happen in the r to the p case where the density was increasing either. It turns out for there to be any hope of circles about the origin being minimizing, just to get them stable, I don't know whether they're minimized, just to get them stable, you need the density to grow very rapidly. You need the log of the density to be convex, concave upward. Second derivative, non-negative. So that's a very rapidly increasing condition. You need at least that, as was discovered by Ken Bracky first, which led naturally to this famous conjecture I want to mention today, feature today, which said that that condition is also sufficient. That is, as long as the balls about the origin are stable, which is this log convex condition, then the balls will be isoperimetric, will be minimizing. So an example of a function like that would be e to the r to the p, as long as p is positive, it's big, greater than or equal to 1, because its log, which is r to the p, is convex as long as p is at least 1. 1 would be the straight line. The square root of r, no, that would be concave down. Concave up when p is 2. So that was, this is this big conjecture. This was this big conjecture, my favorite open problem for a long time. But some results were known. For example, it was known that for density e to the r squared, that particular case, falls about the original minimizing. And that's a very easy case because e to the r squared not only is radial, but it's also a product. It's e to the x squared times e to the y squared. It would give you e to the x squared plus y squared. So that was one case. There was another case I did with some students down in the plain. E to any power p, as long as p is at least greater than or equal to 2, that case, and the way we could do that was by comparing it with similar metrics, related metrics of revolution, because a lot is known about surfaces of revolution, although not in higher dimensions. So that was with some students. That still even left open the case when p was between 1 and 2, where it was conjectured but not known. Then there were some much more general results. So here was the result by Kolesnikov and Zanov in 2010, that it was true for large volumes. And that turned out to be easy, just using the divergence theorem, your favorite thing from calculus. And then there was a theorem by Fagali and Maggi that it was true for small volumes. And often, small things you can do by just knowing what happens at zero and then approximating nearby, that kind of asymptotic analysis. So large and small. But there's a lot of space in between large and small. It means very large or very small. And there was some progress, but not a lot of progress, until in 2013, there was a big new general theorem in this direction, proved independently by three different groups, one right after the other, starting with Cabri and his students in Barcelona. And it said, in any convex cone, not all of Rn, but in a convex cone, that's the limitation, with a very weak hypothesis about density, concavity, homogeno, balls are isoperimetric. So that's the main thing, balls isoperimetric. And the first proof was one that used the so-called mapping comparison. Namely, you take any candidate someone gives you, and you map it to the ball, and you get a comparison that shows the ball has less perimeter. And the map that you use is the gradient of a harmonic map, almost. Actually, you want the map not to have constant Laplacian, not to have zero Laplacian, but constant Laplacian. And that was an old method of Cabre's. His students discovered, to their surprise, that they could make it work even with density. And do we want to give them a chance to talk here? I don't know. Well, here they are. Maybe they will hear them. No. So he says, I had this method for using the gradient of a function with constant Laplacian, which then I didn't work for other densities. But then his graduate students say, we started looking at some very simple examples with density, and we found that we could get Cabre's method to work. And Joaquin Serra says at the end, yes, we were very surprised. So it was a very nice result that those guys had. The second proof by the Granada school was just using an analysis of which shapes are stable. Turned out there weren't even any other stable ones. And the third proof by Milman and Rotten from Israel used a generalization of Brunminkowski. Has anyone heard of Brunminkowski? Okay, good. Next time when you go to a lecture and someone asks, you can raise your hand because you've heard of it now. It's a very famous thing. Very famous thing. And it has a version with density called Borel-Breskant lead. And that just made everything work. So that was a third proof. These were very sophisticated proofs, made us very optimistic, but for no reason, because they did not go anywhere. towards proving the log convex density conjecture. The proof came in 2016 using none of those methods by a third year, by a finishing graduate student at Toronto, Greg Chambers. And he just used what I'd say, a persistent, intelligent approach. Just looking at a differential equation and analyzing it and making estimates for 44 pages. I'm going to say a little more about it, but he deserves a lot of credit for this. He first talked about it in Pisa a couple of years ago. And the idea of the proof, with all these proofs in geometry, you want to start with symmetrization if you can. This green blob has already been symmetrized, as you can see, because it intersects every purple sphere in a spherical cap centered on the x-axis. That's the nature of this symmetrization, which can be shown to always reduce perimeter. So it's reduced to this case, this surface of revolution. And since you're looking at a surface of revolution, it's determined by its generating curve. So you're really just studying curves in the plane that satisfy some differential equation. And what Chambers did was he said, okay, let's start at the place where we're farthest from the origin. And if we stay that distance from the origin, we'll be the circle about the origin. On the other hand, if we start with greater curvature and satisfy the differential equation, we'll spiral inward, which is a contradiction. We're never going to close up nicely. But it wasn't easy to prove. It isn't like it spiraled in consistently, that the curvature was always increasing. It involved you'd have to take pairs of points and make pairwise comparisons. As I said, it was about 44 pages. But that was the proof. This was Greg. I went on a hike with him then near my school, invited him down, and asked him what it was like proving this thing. And here's what Greg had to say. The proof starts with symmetrization. You look at the generating curve and show that it has to spiral inward. But it's not easy to prove. In fact, what surprised me most about the proof was that the estimates are very delicate. So that's a big theorem I'm telling you about today. Here's a related conjecture. It's the same thing true in hyperbolic space. Change the metric a little bit. This looks much harder. I don't know the answer to that. Another conjecture that just came out, which I really like, less than a year ago, was looking at different density, volume and perimeter densities. So the case most interesting, including many applications and previous conjectures, was volume density 1 power of r. And perimeter density, a different power of r. And the conjecture was that balls are isoperimetric if they are stable. And the stability condition here involved both powers, m and k, and also the ambient dimension n. So this, I thought, was an extremely interesting conjecture. Again, there's an easy case which is known. If you have a stronger inequality, then it's easy to prove the minimization. But in general, it looked quite hard, and I had last summer, one of those students in my group wanted to take this on, his undergraduate, and I said, no, it's too hard, don't waste your time on it. And she said, well, I really want, I said, well, you can spend some time on it, don't spend too much time on it. Anyway, they got it. So they actually proved that thing, so that conjecture was proved shortly after its appearance by this group of students here. The leader was this woman here, actually a single parent, and her son was in town. She had to bring her son along too for the summer. So we had some fun with him. And the proof was a lot like Chambers's proof, same kind of argument, only you had to redo all the lemmas and everything, changing from one density to two densities. It's a matter of checking that all those lemmas worked. So that was some undertaking. Another one of the consequences, by the way, was this conjecture about how long the circular arcs are minimizing in the sectors. Also a consequence of this study of two different densities. So finally, Leah, there she is. So you want to meet her, you want to see her talking. She said, you know, Chambers had proved this result for a single density in the plane, and then she went on to study and extend his results to some cases when the perimeter and volume densities are different. A great accomplishment. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Frank. Quindi adesso però possiamo fare anche altre domande se vogliamo su qualsiasi cosa.
They're allowed to ask in Italian.
Puoi provare anche in italiano.
Roberto will translate for me.
No.
Just curious, but why do you always try with a density which goes exactly like R to the M and it doesn't have another kind of symmetry? I understand that R to the M is quite comfortable.
Okay, yes, yeah, no, that's a great question, and now you've already discovered your research, lifetime research program, which is going on to more difficult densities. These are just the easiest ones and the most important ones, so that's where you would start. It's hard even to, I mean, typically, if you took a density at random, then the solution would be some, what, transcendental thing that you would never find exactly. But working out some examples is how we start, right? And what other symmetry would you have other than rotational symmetry? That certainly is the easiest, to have everything be a function of R. I guess you could, translational symmetry is another case you could look at. That's sort of looking at products. Yeah. You know, in math, this is fine. You start, this is what sometimes I notice people are reluctant to do this, but you really have to get your hands dirty and start with looking at examples, and you start with any that you can do and build your way up. That's how theories are discovered. People don't discover these great abstract theories by just sitting and having some great idea come to them. It's by looking at examples. That was such good English, too.
Maybe I missed something. Do you define what you mean by stable?
So stable, it's like in physics, you know, so you might just say better than nearby things. Or like in calculus, second derivative non-negative. So, you know, in calculus, you have equilibrium, derivative zero. Stable, second derivative, non-negative. And you can do the same thing in the calculus of variations. Is that enough?
Vorrei sapere se ci sono risultati analoghi per i semispazi, cioè nel caso gaussiano l'insieme isoperimetrico è un semispazio.
So the question is looking not at the whole plane but the half plane?
sta chiedendo è una peculiarità del piano gaussiano o ci sono condizioni sul peso che danno l'isoperimetria del semispazio, ovviamente.
Looking at the half plane instead of the whole plane?
No, he's asking, in other general conditions under which half spaces are isoperimetric region?
So we found all these places, all these examples where balls about the origin were isoperimetric, and only one example where half planes are isoperimetric. And there are some other examples known where half spaces are isoperimetric, and these are slight perturbations of the Gaussian density, in particular favorable ways. So you already know that for the Gaussian density, the half plane is isoperimetric. And now you add on a term which favors the half plane, and it's still isoperimetric. But that's about all I know about. It does seem to be much more special. Because it's not a result by symmetry, right? I mean, the ball is minimizing if the isoperimetric region just has the symmetry of the problem. That's usually what you expect. Everything else is symmetry breaking, including the half spaces. So they're the unexpected ones. So that was good. Who asked that? That was Isoperimetric. See? Amosato writes back in response to my question, no. Okay, grazie. That means thank you.